Joining us now is Lili Gilvaletta. She has a remarkable resume, including being the CEO of Culture Intel and Send Plus and the spokesperson for Bright Path Labs. So, Lili, I want to start kind of broad picture. The private sector has really kind of emerged as one of the heroes. That's something you don't hear the private sector being talked about too often, especially by some in the media. But how important has the private sector been so far in kind of combating this outbreak?
I think this outbreak is awakening what we know as the public-private partnerships, which is bringing together the ingenuity and the resources of private sector to help with the public good or the public needs that we have right now. So definitely there is a new model emerging. That's why we're seeing corporate CEOs joining the coronavirus task force and updates every single day. And that is positive because we do need to bring all of the biggest and brightest, resources and brains to solve around this issue. It's just unfortunate it took a pandemic for us to do that.
I think you're right. But you're right about a couple things there, too, including the fact that this has kind of surfaced the idea that we are too dependent on China when it comes to a number of different things, but especially when it comes to the production of our medical equipment. Is that something that you agree with?
Absolutely. And, you know, I was a former corporate pharma executive, and I remember in the mid-90s when we started closing down a lot of our facilities here in the U.S. and in Puerto Rico. And here we are now, and Americans may not know this, but 95% of ibuprofen comes from China, 90% of our antibiotics. And right now, when everybody's talking about hydroxychloroquine, you know, we depend on that from China and India. So at times like this, when everyone is protecting their own, of course, I'm going to protect my exports and keep my supply for my people. And this is what's exposing our dependencies from other countries.
Right. And over here, people call that, they would refer to that as nationalism. But in other countries, it seems that they're doing the same thing. They're kind of looking out for their own, kind of putting their interest before the interest of those around the world. But you bring up the hydroxychloroquine thing. And initial reports said that India was going to cut off its supply. They actually produce about 47% of the U.S. Total just stockpile of hydroxychloroquine. Initially, they said that they were going to cut off that stockpile. There are some reports right now saying that they may not do that. But in any regard, is there a way that the U.S. can produce more, or at least get their hands on more hydroxychloroquine in any way?
Yeah, we're hoping that there are negotiations with India that is going to open that up for us, but we cannot just depend and be at the mercy of that supply. That is where American ingenuity needs to kick in. And particularly, I am beyond proud to be involved with a group of American researchers and biologists and PhDs at Bright Path Labs, for example, who have a technology that can produce with agile manufacturing technology hydroxychloroquine right here in the United States. So what we need to do is, while you're negotiating some sort of trade deal with India, also explore who are those innovators right here in the United States that need the acceleration, the attention, and the funding for a time like this, so that we can start activating that innovation to create medicines right here at home. It's a trade-off, it's a balance, and we need to reimagine how this gets done, because we are at the mercy of other sources, and that is a dangerous proposition.
I mean, no doubt. I mean, that would be a major development right there if the government could kind of assist you, if your company, for example, in doing that, because even when it comes to hydroxychloroquine, a lot of the components that make it are once again manufactured in India. So it's something that goes way back to the very substance that is used in order to do this, and it shows how dependent the U.S. is on other countries when it comes to that. But before I let you go, too, what other steps can be taken between private industry and the government in order to kind of allow it to flourish the way that could really help us during this time of need?
Well, we need to tackle what created the problem to begin with. Like, why are we business leaders making decisions to go abroad? Because maybe there are incentives, there are tax reliefs, there are some labor laws or things that are motivating a more efficient or cost-effective model. So the big challenge for the U.S. government, I don't care what party you're on, it's all about how do we incentivize that ingenuity and that innovation to stay here. And that needs some rethinking, because we want to be competitive, but that's only going to happen when it aligns to the benefit of the nation, of the labor force, and also the bottom line of those private companies that have to report to shareholders. So lots of homework, and the economic models are being written as we speak.
Yeah, as you said, it's unfortunate that it took a pandemic for us to have this conversation, but hopefully if there is a silver lining in this disaster, it's the idea that we can at least move on and kind of make ourselves independent once again and kind of move in the right direction after this. But Lili Gilvaletta, I really appreciate you coming on, breaking down this very important partnership between the private and public sector. Thank you very much.
Thank you.